So yesterday we were spending all the time looking at simple and multiple regression where all the predictors were real numbers. Today we're going to look at analysis of variance where the big difference is that the predictors are now factors or categorical variables. Sometimes they are ordered, sometimes they're not. So basically the model is yet again a regression model where you have a dependent variable and then you have an independent variable that is a factor variable and then you have the residuals. Now, how is this different from a linear regression model? Or how is this actually the same as a linear regression model? Have you ever thought of that when you did analysis of variance? So what we looked at yesterday when we were doing the y equals alpha plus beta x plus epsilon, we wrote it, or at least I wrote it, as a matrix vector formulation where I had it as a vector of all the observations from y1 down to yn, and then plus a matrix that I call the design matrix with a column of ones, and then the x1 and xn predictors. Let's get it some subscript up here. And then this should be multiplied by alpha and beta, and then plus the epsilon. One true epsilon n. This was how life was yesterday. That's the linear regression. Now, in this case, just simple, but we can add more. That's trivial, right? Now, in the ANOVA model, there we have that yi equals, you should say ij there, alpha I plus epsilon ij. So basically what you have is you have some levels here and then you have j as a counter for how the observation within that level. So how do we do this when I say it's actually also a linear regression model? So we want to have a reference value. Let's say alpha has three levels, just to not make it totally simple. So we do the same thing here. We have y1 true yn, all of the observations. I use different notation up there. Then I will define some parameters here as alpha 1. And then I'll have alpha 2 minus alpha 1 and alpha 3 minus alpha 1 plus the corresponding epsilons here, epsilon 1 true epsilon n. If this is the case, what do I need to fill in here in order to estimate alpha 1, alpha 2 and alpha 3? That's the question. Yes?
Zeros and ones, right?
Zeros and ones, exactly. Coding for what do I want? So if say the first observation is from alpha 1, what I do then is I have a 1 and a 0 and a 0. So this corresponds to alpha 1. Now if I have an alpha 2 observation, then I need both the alpha 1 and I need the difference to alpha 2. I could also have just written alpha 1, alpha 2, and alpha 3 here. The reason why I do it like this is because that's the way R does it. And then if I have an alpha 3 observation, then it's 1, 0, 1. So that's basically how you code it. And then all of a sudden it's a linear regression where the predictors are just zeros and ones. And then you just fit these parameters. We'll get back to that in a moment, but now just showing how this is actually a linear regression model. But what you typically do when you look at this is that you say you have the total variation. So what you have is you have some groups, let's call them A, B, and C. And then what you have some observations from each group. Let's make B up here. And C could be, let's say, something here. So there's no x-axis here, it's just observations within each of the groups. So what this is, what is the total variation? The total sum of squares. That is, you take the global mean value. Let's make this the global mean value. This is the global mean, and then you look at the residual sum of squares to that. So you take the sum of squares, that, so that's basically just the variance of the data set without dividing by n minus 1. The total sum of squares. Then the other thing is, then you have the treatment sum of squares. We'll get back to that. And then you have for the errors. So that is within each group. The model is that you have a mean value within each group. So then you're looking at what is the variance for what I will call these residuals. It's much smaller. At least in this case. So what matters is the reduction in variance I get from having a global mean value to having these three different mean values. Is that reduction in variance sufficiently large to allow two extra parameters? Because we had a mean value in the beginning, and now we add two more levels on top of that. So that's the story. And the test statistic, the generic, is an F-test where you look at, so the treatment you get back from the difference, but it's basically representing the difference in variance between the blue and the red levels here and the number of observations there. So you have what is the sum of squares for the treatment divided by the degrees of freedom for the treatment to get the F statistic. And that's K, namely the number of groups in that particular variable, in this case 3, minus 2, because we are adding two additional variables, two additional parameters when you do this. And then you normalize with the error sum of squares, that is the blue bars over there, and you normalize that with the degrees of freedom for the error, that is the number of observations minus the number of labels in total. And that follows an F statistic. All the rest is pretty much like linear regression. So what are the assumptions to be fulfilled when we do analysis of variance? Do you recall? Yes?
Linearity,
normality. Yeah, linearity is not quite the same here. It's not needed. But normality of the residuals, yes. So within each group, they should be normally distributed. But when you look at the joint distribution of all the responses, they should not be normally distributed. Because what you have a group down here, you have a group there, you have a group there. But the residuals should be normal. Distributed. And you should also have the same variance in each group. That's the same thing as in the linear regression model saying that they should be IID, they have identical distribution and be independent. And then again, you have non-parametric methods if you departure from normality. And again, you can transform data if needed. So one example here is the so-called folate data, where you're looking at the red blood cell folate concentration in some patients doing anesthesia, and then have different ways of doing ventilation for those. You can have for 24 hours a combination of half nitrous and half oxygen, or you can have the same mixture of gas but only during the operation, or you can have no nitric oxide but only oxygen at low concentration but for 24 hours. And sorry to you, Matthias and Christian, I'm a little bit behind. It took some time to get through the cases. So let me just show you this example. And now I just want to test that my setup changed and works now. So I have the data. So I have some folate concentrations and I have the ventilation here. It's already a factor showing me how many observations I have of each of them. Let me just plot what it looks like with a box plot. When you look at it, it doesn't look always too nice here. You can maybe the variation is a little bit larger in one group than the other, but keep in mind that we only have 5 to 9 observations in each group, so we cannot say much about assumptions about normality or anything in this case. Then in R, you can either use the AOV function for doing analysis of variance, or you can use the LM, because as I explained here, it actually behind the scene is the same thing. So the structure here is the same thing. When you do the summary of an AOV model, you get an ANOVA table, which I hope you have seen, most of you at least, before. And what we see here is we get a p-value here for the ventilation. It's small, just below 5%. So that means there is a significant difference. So being able to prove a significant difference with 22 observations, that's actually, there is really a difference there. So this is one way of looking at it. The alternative way, if we look at what class this is, it's both an AOV and a linear model. So rather than just doing the summary function will always take the first type of class down here and apply that. So the thing is about summary, there are many, around 100 different summary functions for different kind of classes of objects. One of them is the AOV, another one is the summary.lm. So we can make the LM summary of this as well. What does that give us? Well, it gives us an intercept. And remember, why didn't that work? Remember that what we have here, these parameters here, they are indeed not just the alpha 2 and alpha 3 that we have over here. They're the difference between the reference, the intercept here, and this one. And difference between the reference and that one. So what we see here is that we have minus 60 to go from, and now remember, what is the one missing? That is the reference, the first one in the alphabetic sorting. We have it quite far up here. That's the 24 hours, like this. So whenever we want to interpret this, if we want to look at what is actually the expected value at, say, when you have only oxygen, it's 316 minus 38. Because it's the difference to that. It's fairly simple when you only have one way ANOVAs. When you have multiple way ANOVAs, it becomes a little bit more complex. But it's always as a reference level, and all the other parameters are, how is this one different from the reference? That's the one thing to keep in mind. We could also just to play. Use the LM function up here. And then I get the LM summary. It's identical to the summary I got before. Now I don't have the ANOVA table. I could do the summary dot AOV. That will again do the same thing. But what you can do instead of that is to use the ANOVA function, which does the same as summary.aov. So actually, I think my code is here. I'm using the AOV function, but I actually think it's for transparency. I like using the LM for fitting models and using the ANOVA function to get the ANOVA table and the summary to get the coefficients. That's actually my current preference. I know I did not update that all the way down through here, but that could be done, should be done. So if you want to have a different level as your reference level, then what I showed you yesterday is if you can remake the whole factor, but you can also, if you just want to re-level to have it all, another difference, you can just use the re-level and say, I want this factor variable, and now I want to use this one as my reference. So it just changed the order. I took the last one and put that to be the first one. And if I now do the model, my parameters here are different. I did not get 316 anymore. I get 278 as my reference value because I have a different reference. But if I look at the summary, I get the same p-value because it's just different ways of parameterizing the same model. It is the same model. It's just you picking a different reference value. So that's something to play around with whenever you want to. Now, one-way ANOVA, that's easy. Two-way ANOVAs, from a mathematical perspective, is not that much more difficult. Basically, what you have is that you have, instead of just having one group, then you have two different factor levels. And you may have an interaction as well. What does the interaction mean? Well, it means that it depends on, say, ventilation, depends on something else as well. So it depends on ventilation, in this case for the folate data, is in case that depended on whether it was one nurse or the other nurse, just to say something, then there will be an interaction. If it was independent of nurse, then there'll be no interaction. So in this case, the total sum of squares, same thing as over there. You have a treatment sum of squares. We call this blocks because we're not interested in the nurses in that case. We are interested in the ventilation levels, but we have to control for the nurses if there is an effect. And then you have the interaction part, and then you have the error in the end. The model as such is written in a similar way to this. It's just a matter of which combinations do you have. So to give another example, this is yet another one that is between life and death. So we have 9 patients that had congestive heart failure, and then just before and after administration of whatever, then you're looking at what is the heart rate. So is the heart rate in beats per minute affected by that? We have 9 individuals, and you're looking at just before times 0 and 30, 60, and 120 minutes after administration of this drug. Hopefully, there's an effect. So when you just read the data here, the way that we usually do, what we see is that, first of all, we have a case number here. What is the record? We're not going to use that for anything, so let's just get rid of that. Likewise, we have the heart rate here. That's expected to be a number, but the subject here should not be treated as a numeric. We want that to be a factor. Because otherwise we're doing linear regression. If we just, and time is also just a numeric. So if we just use it as it is right now to do a linear model or AOV, what it will do is actually multiple linear regression, like you did yesterday. So we have to make sure that each of the variables have the class or the type that you want it to be. First, let's just remove the first one, just to use the str to show that they are actually integers, not factors as we want them to be. There are two ways to change that. Either when we read in the data, or we can manually say that I want that variable to be a factor. Now I'll show you the difficult way. Do everything in one go. First, the first part is the same. What I add is the column classes. What I say is that I don't want to have the first column, that's an NA. The second column is a numeric, third as a factor, and fourth as a factor as well. So now you can see that subject one has four records, two, four, and so forth. They all have four records, and each time point has nine records. In total, 36 records. And we can see that the type is now factor and factor, as we want it to be. Now, if you want interaction, then instead of having a plus, then you do a multiplication between the different variables. So, I can run this model. Let me do the LM here to update my script. Then I will actually start by doing the, since we have so many different combinations here, the number of parameters that we estimate is quite large. So before doing anything about looking at particular values, I want to know if there is anything significant. So I forgot to run the model. So what do I get? I get no F values and I get no P value. I get a warning message. Actually, if you just do the summary.aov, it's a little bit different in this case. This one here is much more informative because it gives you the missing link. How many degrees of freedom do I have for the residuals? Zero. Is that a good model? This is what is called a saturated model. That means that you estimate parameter, one parameter for each observation. So that means that the residual sum of squares is also zero, because you have a parameter for each observation. Have a weird way of specifying it. If you do the summary of it, you have estimates of all these different interactions and blah, blah, blah. And you have estimates, standard errors, they're not meaningful, so they're not applicable. So whenever you see NAs like this, think of what you did. So what we'll do now is instead we will just do the model without interaction. And let me fix it to be LM again. And do the ANOVA. So what is now the conclusion? Well, there's a big difference between subjects, and there's a difference between the time points as well. So now let's look at what the parameters that we estimated were. So the reference here is time zero, because time zero is missing down here. That's actually quite, I mean, that's convenient. You can say the order down here is maybe not the most obvious. The subject here, also subject one, is the reference level. So if you want to look at subject three at time 30 minutes, then you have to take the intercept up here, plus, which means minus 5.7, and minus 4 again. So could we do something smarter in this case? So what is the expected effect. That is, well, you do give this drug, and then you see things are changing. We see that the heart rate is 4 less 30 minutes after, minus 5, 60 minutes after, minus 4, 120 minutes after. The standard deviation for those estimates is 1.6. So if you consider 1.6 as a standard error, then I find that those three values are actually quite close. Do you agree? At least within the max and minimum is within one standard error. So maybe it doesn't matter how long time after you measure, it's just after the administration and before the administration. Oh, that's something different. This was just to compare with the first model to look, because you can also use ANOVA to compare two models. If you have two models that are nested, it works fine. In this case, you don't have any degrees of freedom for the residuals in the first one, so we cannot test anything. We can make a third model where you just look at the effect of time, and then do the ANOVA of that one. So time alone is not significant, only when you correct for the subject. And if we look at comparing those two models, we also see a significant difference. If there is a significant difference between two models, you should pick the more complicated one. If there's no significant difference, you can pick the least complicated one. So now we get into, I create an extra column in my data set that I call time. Then I take the labels here and I give them some new names. So I give them before and then I repeat after three times for the last three time points. Then I run the same model as before, just with time two. Let me write LM. Let me do the ANOVA first. So the conclusion is, again, both things are significant. Actually, if you look at the ANOVA, what we want to test is which model is better. Is it the one where things are not combined, or the one where we only have the before after? So we can do an ANOVA comparing the two models. We save 2 degrees of freedom by combining the three after measurements to one time point, just the after, and we get a p-value of 0.64. So what is the conclusion? There's no significant difference between having a before after and having a before and 30, 60, and 120 minutes after, as 4 levels versus 2 levels. So which model should we use in this case? Yes? Yes, indeed. When there's no significant difference, you should pick the simpler model. If there's significant difference, pick the more complicated one. And if we look at the parameters that we estimate, now we get minus 4.5 as the estimate here. Before, the standard error was 1.6. Now we're down to 1.3. So our estimate is also more certain, which is why the p-value here is significantly smaller than what it was before. The last bit here is just to change the time entirely to have different levels, so they have them in the chronological order rather than in just alphabetic order, which was what happened before. Just to show you what's called an interaction plot, let me just zoom in here. So you have a line for each of the subjects, and the numbers just squeezed outside my plotting window. That's beautiful. You can see them down here. So you have a line for each of the subjects, and it's very clear that each of the subjects have their own level for the heart rate. I bet the same thing applies in here. Depends on how fit you are, among other things. and what you've been doing just recently. And then you see a lot of different behaviors when you change over time. So this is one way to show all combinations. What was that one there? So here you can see what happens for all the individuals, all 36 observations in one plot. What you want to kind of look at is any general trend here. It's not so easy to see here, but most individuals have a decrease from the first observation to the following ones. But some particular subject two here goes up again a little bit. But that's just how random things are. And now, when you look at the first one here, I used the full names with he, daughter, and then the column name. But what you can also do is, if you don't want to write this, rather than using attach and detach, what you can do is to use the with. That means that everything that happens inside after this comma is assuming that the he here is attached, so to speak. So that means you can just use the column names without having the prefix in everything that comes in there. Just to do the same plot, the thing is just that the values here, the labels here are just nicer in this case, but mostly just to show you what width does. So if you're going to use a lot of columns and do a lot of things, and you don't want to write the data name of the data frame dollar something too many times, width is a good help to do things. So I think that was what I wanted to say for now. Basically now you can do all the exercises for today. What I'll do in the afternoon is A, talking about group forming and talking about how to use Knitter and Markdown to kind of make LaTeX and Markdown combinations, so you don't have to have your code and your reports in separate documents, but you can combine it all together. And then I'll show you some tips and tricks of various things. So that's the program for the rest of the day. That also means for those of you who have been pushed and challenged for the first few days because maybe you did not haven't seen R before, this afternoon is also where I expect you have time to catch up with whatever is left. I will soon upload my sample solutions to the exercises you've shown so far, so you also have those to look at. Any questions? Sorry? No, it's not a requirement to use LaTeX. It's fine to use whatever you like. It's just because typically many like using either LaTeX or something different, and then it's nice to just combine things. Avoiding copy-paste. Whenever I can avoid copy-paste by writing a bit of code, you'll see me writing code. What is a requirement is that when you hand in, it's a PDF file. And I think that's a fair requirement. Good. Any other questions?